and more that you no longer get this, to be a little bit, of course, in a mocking way, to simplify it a little bit, you know, this elementary patients who say, "Ooh, last night I was dreaming about penetrating a thick forest, killing a dragon and entering the castle," and then you say, of course, the dragon is your father, the castle is your mother." No, they already come with an interpretation. They say, "I think I'm obsessed and neurotic." They already come with, you can no longer surprise them, which is why also the interpretation no longer has this shocking truth effect. It's no longer, "Oh my God, no, my mother," or what. I remember one friend really told me that. He tried to repeat this Freudian joke when some guy, you know this well-known Freudian joke, Freud says that when you ask a patient, "Who is that woman in your dream?" And when he says, "I don't know who this is, but it's certainly not my mother," it means, "Ha, ha, ha, it is, no?" That a patient told him, "I don't know who this woman is, but I'm sure it must have something to do with my mother," no? Not a problem. They concede everything in advance. So again, the problem, not only this, I was even told, and this is a wonderful detail, it's not only that they offer interpretations. You already have even symptoms which are in advance structured with a view to their possible interpretation. You can have not Lacanian readings, you can have Lacanian symptoms, Anna Freudian symptoms, Jungian symptoms, and so on and so on. So again, is the conclusion the totally cynical one? Some people think that interpretation is powerless. So we need, I don't know, either some are returning to hypnosis, the other to some kind of more direct physical interventions or what. I don't think. If I just conclude with this, okay, there are other things I wanted to do, but fuck it, let's stop. To conclude it, I don't think that. I think that, that's my big mantra, that cynicism is an impossible position. Every, you know, my old story, maybe you know it, that I like to repeat, here is the experience I had, that I claim that cynicism always involves a fetishist position. And with this standard line of mine, I will conclude, maybe you know it, but I think it's crucial, that if the standard ideology functioned more like a symptomatic text, today's cynical ideology is fetishist. What do I mean by this? In symptomatic functioning, you are within a field of a lie. A symptom is the return of truth. Like, you deny something, you live a lie, but then you are reminded through symptoms of the falsity of your position. You know these ridiculous examples, which I like. Let's say you are a troubled adolescent, you want to escape sexuality, let's say into pure mathematics, but then whatever you do there, like, it's somehow, like, all of a sudden you have a task, how much water you need to fill a tube like that, oh my God, it's there. How much energy is discharged when two bodies hit, oh my, you know what I mean, everything. So this would be the symptomal logic. You are in a general global field of a lie, the truth returns. Or let's make a more simple example. Let's say somebody more serious, somebody close to you dies. You try to forget it, erase it, throw yourself into work, but of course, you encounter some object, something which reminds you of what you tried to forget. But the cynical position is a different one. It's a much more open, tragic one even. It's fetish. This is why I call it. Fetish is not the truth which returns in a field, the global field of lie. It's the lie which enables you to confront the truth openly. What do I mean by this? Let me give you a totally crazy story. It's so crazy that my only justification is that it truly happened some 15 years ago to a friend of mine. His wife died. They were happily married, young, beautiful wife, and it was the usual. I don't want to think about this story, you know. You go to a doctor, haha, breast cancer, you know, if you get it young, in 2-3 months, she was dead. Okay, what surprised all of us, his friends, is how calmly this friend of ours took this. It wasn't, you shouldn't mention his wife and so on. After her death, he was ready to talk about her. Oh, sorry?
It's the story of the mouse, the little mouse.
No, it's the hamster, yeah. That's the point. Yeah, how, you know, he was, but then we noticed something, that all the time he was doing it, he was playing with a hamster. The hamster was the favorite pet of the wife, so the hamster was the fetishist denial. It signaled as if I can talk about it, but the hamster meant I don't really take it seriously, psychologically, I still disavow. It was a fetish enabling him to disavow the death of his wife. The proof, again, was a very vulgar one. Now you will say this is wild analysis. Ah. The proof was that a year later the hamster died. The guy seriously tried suicide, he had to be hospitalized. It was clear that the hamster, this clinging to the hamster, was the fetish which allowed him to. And we often are like Patricia Highsmith, I mentioned her, my favorite, haha, detective writer. I don't know which of her collection of short stories she had, I mentioned it sometimes, a wonderful short story called The Button. About a guy who lives a totally desperate life. His child is, how do you call this, mongoloid, heavily. Yeah, whatever, blah, blah, a freak. And he's desperate. One evening he goes out, desperate of it, encounters a homeless guy, beats him to death, just exploding, then tears off a button, puts it into his pocket, and returns home and feels much better. And from then on he can deal with his son. This button is his fetish. Like, once I was able to strike back, it's not so, and so on and so on. So what I'm claiming is that whenever you talk to a cynical person, who says, I'm a total realist, no illusions, there is no love, all that matter is money. But I like these cynical sayings, you know, like these versions of, like, money is not everything, no, but it comes pretty close to it. or this, the best cynical answer a friend of mine gave me to, you know, when I was adolescent, we were involved in these cheap imaginations, and one of us said, oh, I would like to have a big house with 10 women in it to play all the time. Then a friend of mine said, no, I would prefer to have one woman and 10 big houses, and so rent the other houses so that I would be able to eat. Okay, so what I want to say, whenever somebody plays that, this would be for me the big rule of psychoanalysis, how you should approach a cynical person. Every cynicist has his or her hamster. Nobody can be really. And you can really look at it. If you look from what we know about horrible people, like Hitler, Stalin, whatever, nobody was totally. It can be the family, the son for whom you sacrifice yourself, whatever. My thesis is that even. That's how the so-called Western Buddhism functions. This is one of the big hamsters that we have. You know how, this is what always fascinated me, how if you look for propaganda for these transcendental meditation courses, first they give you the official mantra. We live in society where we care too much for material goods, you should find peace to find inner. But then always there is a second paragraph where they tell you, and through meditation in this way you will function even better on the market there, and so on. So what I'm saying is that, you know, this is how you can dupe yourself. You can tell yourself it doesn't really matter. It's just a game I'm playing as a businessman. What really matters is my rich inner. No wonder this kind of cheap Buddhist, pseudo-Buddhist meditation is so popular. I mean, I read some interesting investigations where they claim that a kind of a vaguely westernized meditative wisdom is by far already the predominant religious attitude among top managers. They are already out of Christianity. They are already in this. So again, my point would have been that we should stick to maybe not classical interpretation, but that words still can do their job. I don't buy this totally cynical view, like, you know, we can just, no. That's my Lacanian a priori, how should I put it? Nobody is a total cynic. Every cynic has